Hi there, folks. In today's demonstration, I'm going to show you how you can dynamically add a table into Excel using Power Automate. You probably know that there are native actions that let you list rows in a table. If your file comes through via email or you're uploading a file without a table and you trigger that flow, then unfortunately, using those native actions, you can't read the data. And you might have also noticed that if you use the offset formula that's often shared online, that it might miss out some of those rows, and also it's not dynamic to cater for varying column widths. So I've got a formula today, and I'll demonstrate why this should work so that it'll identify your full data set within an Excel file and also dynamically calculate the number of columns so that you can use that to add a table to your Excel files as you automate with Power Automate Cloud Flows. So I'm going to start things off from this Excel workbook. I have two worksheets which are identical, sheet one and sheet two. I have 8 columns of data, and if I use Control and End, I have 4,847 rows of data. Using Control and Home back to the top, we can see the key thing in this data set is that I have several empty cells. And this is one of the key reasons why the most shared formula for identifying a table via Power Automate fails, because the formula is based on non-empty cells. So I've developed a formula using Copilot. I've reasoned over why that formula should work, and I've tested it, and I've now successfully identified dynamically not only the number of rows based on the last non-null data, I've also dynamically identified the number of columns. So to demonstrate this, over on Power Automate, I have a very basic flow. One, to create a table with the offset that you'll commonly see shared in forums. And we have a fixed value here for the number of columns, in which case I have 8. And then we have a subtotal. And that subtotal is based on a sheet name, but also non-null values based on everything that's in column A. Over on the right-hand side, I have a similar looking formula, again using offset, but I'm using a lookup. And that lookup will find the last non-null value in all the rows within your sheet. Then I have a formula that will check to see how many non-null values I have in the first row to identify the column width. So if we put this flow into test, I'll show you the result, and then maybe we can explore why these formulas work or don't work.
Hi folks, sorry to interrupt. I hope you're enjoying the video. Please make sure you like and subscribe and leave me a wee comment down below. I'll let you get back to the video, and I'm off to go and play with these guys. Enjoy.
So both of these actions run in similar timescales. If I jump back across onto my Excel sheet and refresh, we can see that sheet one has added a table. But again, if I use Control and End, we've got a series of rows that have not been selected. And the reason those have not been selected is because the previous formula that has been published online identifies the row count based on the number of non-null values. And we'll see the table eventually end here at 3910. And that's presumably because I have about 1,000 rows that have null values, like you can see here. If I jump across onto sheet one, not only has it correctly identified the number of columns, if I use the Control and End, it's also correctly identified the number of rows, and the table has fully captured that data set. Now, if I bring up the two formulas side by side here, we've got the original formula and then the new one that I've developed. If we have a look at this first expression here, it's calculating the number of active rows. And if I copy that into a cell, I can use the expression bar here and paste it in. I would expect it to give me 4847, but you can see it's given me 3911, and that's because it counts the non-nulls. If I use this lookup expression that I've just highlighted here and paste that into the cell beneath with an equals, we can see we get 4847. So it correctly identifies the number of rows based on the last non-null value in column A. Now, when it comes to the column count, I have a fixed value of 8 in the first formula, but using this expression, count A, if we copy that and I paste that in here side by side with an equals, you can see it can correctly count the number of non-null values in our row A. If I jump back up to the top here and I'll insert that same formula with are equals. At the moment it's 8. If I add in a value into I, new column, you can see it's 9. Again, if I do another new column, it's now 10. So that is completely dynamic. When we run that expression in Power Automate, it will look at that top row, number 1, and it will identify the number of non-null values that are in that column. So using this expression, not only will you be able to identify the number of rows in your data, you'll also be able to dynamically identify the number of columns. Now, if I bring up my trusty friend Copilot over on the right-hand side, this is the free version of Copilot. You can see that I've spent some time already querying the expressions that I've written. But what I'd like to do is to compare the two formulas that I've just showcased on screen. Do they do the same thing? Can you tabulate how they differ? And I'll ask that question to Copilot. So we can see that our first formula is based on sheet 2, a starting cell of A1. The offset for the rows and the columns start at 0. That applies to both of the formulas that we have. And then the height is based on the non-empty cells in column A of sheet 2, considering only visible cells. In my formula 2, we have this height based on the number of rows of the last non-empty cell in column A, which is the difference between the two formulas. And the width, rather than being fixed of 8, is based on this count, which will count the number of non-empty cells in row 1 of sheet 1. So if we compare the two formulas side by side, the height is now based, rather than the non-empty visible cells, it's based on the last non-empty row in column A. And rather than a fixed width, we now have a dynamic width based on that count A. So as a conclusion, formula 1 is useful when you want to count only visible cells and have a fixed width. Formula 2 is more dynamic, adjusting the height based on the last non-empty cell and width, based on the number of non-empty cells in the first row. And I was able to work through building this formula by using Copilot to try and understand the most efficient way of identifying the last non-empty row within a range of data. But let's see how we can adapt the original flow that I've built here to add a table to a file that I upload into SharePoint. So if I start with a basic flow that has that trigger with the formula that I've created, and I'll swap out this trigger to when a file is created, and we'll search for when a file is created, and we'll choose the properties only. I'll attach this to a SharePoint site, and I have my Damien demo site, to a library, which will be my default document library called Documents. Then next, all we need to do is update this create a table with an offset to include a dynamic file name. So I can remove that fixed file name, go into the lightning bolt for dynamic content. And if we search for the identifier, we'll dynamically be able to pass that into our create table action. It'll use our offset and it'll create a table based on the table name that we've added here. So if we save this, put it into test, and if I jump across onto SharePoint, I'm going to drag and drop a brand new file across that has no table. Open up that file. We can see right now there's no table present, but if I jump across onto my flow, the flow completes within a few seconds. And if I jump back across onto my Excel file, we can see that the Excel file has now been updated. And if I use my control and end, it's created a table based on all of those rows and all of those columns using that updated formula.